Yo, what is up, everybody? Joshua Casper back at you with Plugin Boutique, and I got a crazy good video for you today. It's over 30 minutes of tips, tricks, and techniques from Guy of Disclosure. This was boiled down from a 2.5 hour live stream that I did with Guy on Beatport's Twitch about a month ago. If you missed that stream, it's probably because you're not following Plugin Boutique's Instagram. That's where we post this sort of information when I'm gonna be doing a takeover of Beatport's Twitch or anywhere else on the internet. So if you're not following there, make sure you are today. I'm gonna leave a link in the video description. And in the meantime, enjoy over 30 minutes of tips, tricks, and techniques from Guy of Disclosure.
Hello, if you're just joining, by the way, Guy from Disclosure making a little disco edit for my DJ sets. The break. She's sounding pretty reverb-y, actually. The first thing I'm going to do is take some of that reverb out. And my favorite plugin for that is this Transient Master by Native Instruments. Look at what this thing does, man. So good. I find it a little extreme when you get up here, but I find what works really well is if you put it on like 30% and then have another one after it, then you get a real nice, clean, choppy sound rather than one doing all the work. So you just have two. Even three if you want to go like really. I think that's too dry for this tune, but I find that works really well just in tandem, and it uses like no CPU. So next up, I want to get it rocking. So big kick, 4/4 kick for this tune. So I've just dragged one of those sidechain things down because it's an instant 4/4 MIDI pattern. And that's going to sound like this. So for me, that kick is just ahead of the beat. So what I'm going to do now is drag all this a bit off grid until it sounds good. Notice that I haven't quantized it. I like how it sort of flows a bit. I want it to be not perfect, but I want it to still just attack. I kind of learned that through DJing, because when you're beat matching in DJing, something drifts out of time. It can sound so unsatisfying. So when you're making a disco edit, you have like full control over how much overlap you want the kick and the sample to have. Yeah, it's weird. That's a pure just like practice makes perfect kind of thing. Like, that's what I like it like. And if I had it, say I had it spot on the grid, like, well, yeah, there. It just doesn't have like the punch, because it's like the before each kick is what's given it so much like whammy. Tiny little things like that, man, I've learned over time. Like late snare, like just not good. Push it forwards. Can we go even more? Split the difference. All right, now I'm gonna start thinking about how I want that kick to sound. Like, what tuning? Do I want it like 90s? Or do I want it techno? Do I want it long? I mean, at this stage, they all sound good. So until you've got like the rest of the music in there and some percussion and hi-hats and whatever, it's hard to tell. So I would stick to short at this stage and just keep it punchy. Quite nice low, actually. I like it very low and very short, I think. So the kick is just doing that. Take a bit of that attack off. Hear that click? Look, that's full EDM vibes. Feeling 909 for sure, which is these ones. I've set this one up to have like a gate. So if I hold it down, it does like a long one. And if I hold it down, like, it does a short one. And that's how you can get those really nice like French house swing patterns that, you know? So I'm sure we'll do a bit of that. Yeah, let's just jam it. Quantize that. probably, I think this tune is straight. I don't think it's swung, but we'll see. How did you do the battery hi-hat gate thing? Oh yeah, good question. Here's battery. Here's said hi-hat. Oh, come on. Yeah, so, yeah, if I'm holding down the note, it plays the whole thing. If I just hit it short, then it does that. So the way you want to do that is with the volume envelope here. By default, I think it's set to this, which doesn't help you. You want to put it on that mode, which is attack, hold, decay, sustain, release mode. Pull the sustain and decay all the way down and have the hold all the way up. Hold is what you want. When you're holding down the note, the sample is going to be let through. And then when you let go of the note, it's going to stop. And release also comes into it, because when you release the note, do you want it to just completely stop, or do you want it to sort of fade out? So if I put the release up, it's still got a bit of to it. If I pull that down, it's insane. So somewhere in between is usually fine. I like that. That's how I do it. Cool. Happy with that. Got that going through some overdrive. See, I've got all these plugins laid out already on my project. I just don't like to mess around. Like, I know what I'm going to need. I know I'm going to need EQ on all my drums. I know I'm going to want some overdrive. I know I'm going to want some saturation, some compression. Make a template that has all that stuff. I used to open a blank template and then just spend so much time doing that. Like, where's waves? Where's universal? Oh, now look at that. I've got to go through this. Just get it all on. If you've got the CPU, just do it. Cool. I think we could layer it up with some hand claps. Here's a good plugin for you guys. Hand Clap Studio by Robotic Bean. Best hand claps in town. Pitching around, you got the number of clappers. There's just one guy in a room. Different types of clap. Even got snaps. And each time you press it, it's a little different sample. You can spread them around. And if you put it on 8, and you have like full looseness, because like here's no looseness. Just sounds like one clap, a little bit. Bit better. If you put it on full, it's just a damn round of applause. Thank you very much. I'm gonna go with not a round of applause. I think maybe 5. I quite like having one down the middle and then some each side, like that, a bit looser. Let's see how it sounds in the mix. Looser. Clap, clap. That's cool. That little get down with the genie is going to be great. Yeah, and I'll probably start to do some quantizing. Ooh. Some quantizing now, because we're gonna get into a bit of a mess otherwise once all the music's in. I'll probably only quantize it to like quarter notes, just so that the like kick and snare are roughly on the beat. But yeah, then you should still have you could even do half notes, to be honest, just so the kick is on the beat. It just brings it all together. Yeah, I'm going to check this quick with a click. Yeah, see, I can hear that's behind. That doesn't need to be so behind. That can be there. Sometimes, like, you just got to listen rather than do the math. Yeah. Early. Grab that, drag. drag it back a bit more. Cool, that'll do. It definitely needs neatening up, but it'll work for now. Cool, there's a bass note, just one bass note going on, which is good for me because I don't really do notes. It's an E. So I'm going to put a little bass in, just like a boom, boom, boom. Nice and short. Oh yeah. Yeah. All right, so now I'm going to sidechain that bass line with the drums. So that's a full sidechain. Sometimes what I like to do with bass, what's the time? 6:15. Yeah, cool. Sometimes I like to sidechain just the sub using a multiband compressor. Instead of just a compressor. The difference being you can compress just certain bits of the sound rather than the whole thing, the whole volume. So for a bass line like that, you want this stuff to still come through, like the ding, 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 but you don't want the like, woo, 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 woo. That stuff's gonna clash with the bass. It's just gonna let the note come through a bit more. Yeah, and you can combine it if you want. You can do a bit of that and then a little bit of the whole thing. This compressor setting is based off a DBX 160, which we could just use, actually. Let's use the real thing. DBX 160. Great compressor for bass and guitars. Oh, they've updated it. It looks nice. Can you hear how it just adds that little click at the start of the bass, like that tick, 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 just gives it some like. So that's without, now with. Yeah. It's too much. Without. Soft. Softness with, you know what, you drive it a bit harder, and then there's a mix knob here. I never even spotted that. Maybe that's new. I'm gonna have it in at like 3 o'clock. Cool. And then I always have bus 3 set up as chorus. I love Logic chorus. See how it says there, bus 3 Logic chorus. Check out the difference on this. Here we go. Big, wide 80s bass. just hear the sides come alive. That Logic chorus is pretty much the sound of Disclosure. That's how I have it set. And I take out all the sub. You don't want to be putting sub bass through chorus, in my opinion. I mean, it's fine, but like, I don't like panning the sub. I like it down the middle. So this enables me to have like the dry signal from the synth just doing the mono, and then the chorus is just the mids and highs going outwards. You want to mono the sub really because of like vinyl. I know that sounds weird, but if you've got a mad stereo bass going on and you put that song on vinyl, the needle can literally jump out, which I only learned like a few years ago when I first started having to actually make vinyl for our songs. Not myself, but getting vinyl made. And I was always like, why is all the mastering guys monoing the bass? And it's because of that. The needle will jump off the record if you don't have the bass monoed. So, and it can sound weird in a club. If you're in a club and there's like a 360 sound system and you've got sub coming from all directions, you just get weirdness. Mono your sub and then send it to some chorus. Did you take any precautions when it comes to not damaging your ears while in the studio, like a volume limit on your speakers? Nothing like mathematical, nothing scientific. Like, there's not like a set piece of equipment that's doing it. I just try and not have it that loud, especially when mixing. When making a tune, I have it pretty damn loud. Yeah, I'm having fun. You only live once and all that. You know, to get the initial vibe, I think it's fine to do that. But yeah, not for hours and hours and hours. You want to find a balance somewhere. What I do sometimes, again, when if I'm in a session and it's really loud, and like say you just need it on loop for someone to write lyrics to, and they want it loud, I will put Soothe, which is a sick plugin, on the output track of the song if they want it really loud, just so we're not all hurting our ears. Like, Soothe takes all of the harsh frequencies out of anything. So if you put it on the output track while people are writing to the song, that definitely saves you a lot of tinnitus. I also always keep a few plugins on the output track. It's not there right now, but I would have an EQ on the output track. Sometimes if I'm writing really loud, I will just by default just do that. Just take out all the highs, because that's what hurts your ears. So, and then, you know, you just put it back later. So yeah, I do, I just check myself on it regularly, but no, I don't have like a limit or anything. I love pre-delay so much on Reverb. Like, it's night and day better. Like, here it is with no pre-delay. So the reverb's just gonna go, and then I'll play it with pre-delay. So it goes, comes like after the sound. Like, it's good, but it's just so much more like interesting and like swingy. Cool, little trick with ride cymbal. What I like to do, that's just a boring old down the middle ride cymbal. Get your sample delay. Or whatever, really. I don't know what the Ableton equivalent is. There's probably like a way of doing it. But what this does is just delays the signal in one of the speakers. So if I delay the left speaker, if you're wearing headphones, you'll... Now it sounds like there's two hi-hats. But if you just do it a touch, then you get this immediate, like, humongous width. And kind of chorus-y effect as well. It goes a bit phasey. That's without. That's with. And, you know, we've already got a big 909 hi-hat going straight down the middle. So now we've just got this super wide, like, open everything, which I like. I might sidechain that ride as well, just make it bounce a bit. Give it a bit of swing. Well, not swing, but you know what I mean. That thing. Yeah. There you go, some filtering. Yeah, here's my drum bus, for those wondering. A drum bus is kind of like a channel on the software where all of the drums individually end up, so you can control them on one fader. So like, for example, all of these are my drums, or potential drums. I'm not using all of them. The ones highlighted I'm using. But they all end up here. So if I solo these, all you'll hear is drums. And if I pull it down, so it's basically summing them together. And once you sum them together, then you can get into putting them through some effects. And so we're gonna, first of all, put them through this thing. Need it with the break, really, don't I? Where's the break? Yeah, it only happens once. Yeah, I did say this was going to happen. There's a good chance I might put everything through the drum bus. And it'll almost be like the master chain, except for the bass. The bass I won't put through, but let's see how it sounds. Nah, don't like it. Put him back. Cool, all right, that's all that's going through the drum bus then, is these kind of snares and the ride cymbal thing. So I'm gonna put some tape saturation on there as well. This thing, you'll hear it go all squelchy. So that's way too much, but a little bit goes a long way. Before. After. Just giving it that like fizzy, squelchy top end. The hi-hats are all kind of, just sounds a bit more analog. This thing's amazing. Just more saturation. Probably don't need that. Yeah, I'm gonna take out some highs. It's a bit. Yeah, not loads, but just a little bit. And then a little limiter. You can see it's just catching where the clap, snare, and kick all happen at the same time. So it's just like, just making sure it doesn't distort, basically. But it's really not very drastic limiting. I don't like to limit stuff very hard until, like, the main output. But even then, I don't love, like, ramming it through the limiter. I like some dynamics. Yeah, so as you can see, it's taking off, like, 2 dB. It's nothing. So there's our plugins on the drum bus. Here's the before and after. Take them off. So you can see we're peaking at minus 4.3. So not much headroom. And it sounds, you know, kind of, I don't know how it sounds. Like, it sounds good. It sounds punchy. There's nothing wrong with it, but A to B. To me, that sounds fuller, fatter, controlled, a bit louder, but we're peaking at -8. So technically it's quieter, but it sounds louder to the human ear. That's what you want with drums, I think. So you've controlled them. There's no like transients popping out everywhere and meters hitting the red, but your ears don't notice it, that it's actually quieter. It's a funny old one. See? Minus four. Plugins on. Minus eight, but it sounds louder. Takes a bit of practice to get that one right, but that's how I do it. Combination of compression, tape saturation, and a little limiter. This is my master chain for those who want to copy me. I'll loop this section so you can hear what it's doing. So first up is the SSL G-Bus compressor. It's without. I mean, it's minor, really minor stuff. You're not really even going to hear what that's doing, to be honest, until you're really like looking at the meters and studying what's going on with the volume. Oh, I'm actually in the red. Let's pull that down. I was boosting it so you guys could hear it loud. It might dip a bit in volume now, just FYI. Yeah, we're coming in quite hot, actually. I would usually back things down a little bit. We're a bit close to the red, so I'm just going to pull it all down. This is my master fader, so before it goes to the master out, I send it all through this effects bus here, just in case I want to put an effect on the whole song, like, randomly. It just gives you that option. Everything ends up through one fader before the end, so like if I wanted to do this, I could. Or whatever, you know. Just lets you kind of DJ the tune before it goes to the plugins. We're not going to do that today, but I am going to pull the volume down just a bit. Yeah, the bass is really loud. So it's almost the same as my my drum bus in terms of plugins. There's a few different ones like this. This is a multi-band compressor. Saturn. Wow, that's really distorting, but I kind of like it. Yeah, that's sick. I would usually only have that on about 10%, but with this tune, I think it sounds pretty powerful up there. Maybe a little bass boost on the way out. I'd probably use a sort of fancier EQ for this. I don't know what though. Like the precision EQ or something? What's it called? I got the license for that? No. Start the demo. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, so I'm just adding some like sub, bit more like welly down there, and then a little sprinkling of highs, super highs, just to give it some shine. So this is not. And then on. I mean, yeah, really subtle. That's 1.5 dB, 1 dB on the highs. And then I would, okay, so now I'd probably put it through Soothe, but I'm not going to because it's so CPU heavy. And while I'm streaming to you guys, it'll probably destroy the stream. So I'm not going to do that. I would also limit it with this limiter. I'll try the limiter. The limiter is also pretty CPU heavy. If, as long as I don't use oversampling, we should be okay. It's going to get pretty loud now in your headphones, so watch out. That's sounding pretty banging. All right, from the top, I'm going to listen to this structure. Now we've got all the plugins on there, so I know how it should sound. It's going to be loud and tasty. Let's have a listen.